the Turkish side, they want, they don't even recognize the Kurdish being. I mean, they are refusing any Kurdish being, any Kurdish administration, refusing the system also, denying the Kurdish being, denying this system already existing since 2013. It's 3 years now of the people are managing themselves. So those parties doesn't accept the system. I don't know how we can, already I mean, some of them, they are making their demonstrations and so on. If anybody or anyone just arrested or detained by for the any criminal, they say, well, it's a political detainees, which is not at all. I mean, there is nobody detained for their political view or political activities. It's just for ordinary crimes. Maybe some of them, some of those people are detained. This is one. And related to the other questions, I mean, just like I mean, the other speaker, and dear Lisa, was mentioning to PKK. Well, we are not affiliated with the PKK. We decide for Rojava. We have our administration. We can do it. Maybe PKK, there is no presence of PKK. But if there is some people, I mean, joining YPG or whatever it is, they are Syrians. We don't look at their, maybe they were maybe 10 years or maybe 5 years ago, they had some relations, but now they are defending their families, their relations, relatives in Syria. And of course, we would like to have the relations with all Kurdish party. From our side, there is any Kurdish party or Kurdistani party like PUK, PDK, PKK, the others. We would like to have good relations with them. It's good for us. And some other point which was mentioned also, of course, the peace in Turkey is for our favor. We would like the Kurdish issue to be solved in Turkey. What I mean, how they do it, we don't know, but it depends on them. But we know there is a fight going on in Turkey. It's kind of war, really. And maybe we can even consider these attacks to Syria and the Kurds is just to draw the attention of the public attention to the this side instead of to be engaged in the Kurdish issue inside, because in daily, really, I mean, in daily basis, there are casualties, there are fightings. 2 days ago, there were just, I mean, the news were talking about 86 soldiers killed in somewhere and 47 soldiers killed some other places. So there is a conflict and there is a fighting going inside Turkey with their Kurds, and they maybe just to draw the attention, public attentions of Turkey and internationally, they're making this invasion and trying to everybody to be engaged with Rojava instead to look into Turkey. So this is another question. Well, as a result, I mean, for the pluralism, we believe in it and we would like to do, to implement it because not only for Rojava, but for all of Syria. Thank you. Any more questions? We are ready to answer.
Thank you, Mr. Stale.
Other questions?
Thank you. My couple of questions for Mr. Muslim, quickly. Sir, are you planning to go for Al-Bab? My first question. Second question, there are some talks in this town that the US administration has given you green light to go to Al-Bab. Is that your understanding? You stated that Turkish army does not have any intention to fight with ISIS. Just today, another ISIS attack according to reports, killed three Turkish soldiers, and I think this is the third ISIS attack reported. How do you explain these attacks? Thank you.
Well, should I answer?
Yes, please, go ahead.
I couldn't understand the first question, the second one, okay.
Are you planning to go to Al-Bab?
Oh, Al-Bab, yeah. Actually, we are not planning to go anywhere because we have political party and we have our activities. And as you know, there is Democratic Syrian Forces. And these Democratic Syrian Forces, they are fighting. But they are not talking about Al-Bab. As you know, there was a military council for Al-Manbij, which was Democratic Syrian Forces were helping them. And also in Jarablus, we have now a military council for Jarablus, and Al-Bab also, and they have military council for Al-Bab, which is mainly from people located in Al-Bab or their around Bab, villages, suburbs of the Bab. They're containing some Kurds because, as everybody knows, historically also, the Shahba area and the place between Jarablus and Afrin, we have about the population of it is around 50% are Kurdish. And the villages over there, we know these villages. Most of them, they were Kurds living together with the Arabs and Turkmens and whatever they are. But the 50%, not less than 50%, they were Kurdish villages and Kurdish population. And they are locals. So those Kurds living there in Jarablus villages and in Manbij villages, in Al-Bab villages, just like Namane, Ashtut, Sorok, whatever it is, I mean many villages, we know these villages, they are purely Kurdish and they are now joining this Al-Bab military council. So of course, and already they have some brigades called revolutionary brigades in this area. So I think they are resisting against those ones, the Turkish invasion and those DAESH and the others. And as the latest news we hear, those groups, especially this Sultan Murad brigades, they are cleansing these areas from the Kurdish people. I mean, and just the Kurdish population are arrested or just pushed away from their villages. That's what they are doing. I mean, this is the aim of Turkish government to make demographic changes. And they are implementing. I mean, they are doing which is ordered by Turkey. We know that. For the fighting against Daesh, let's just go back a little bit. We believe also a part of Daesh, maybe not all of it, but part of Daesh was created by Turkey just to fight the Kurdish people. As you know, starting from Shengal to the other areas, Serikane, Kobane, all of them, they were attacked by Daesh. And this Daesh, which attacked our areas, they have very, very good connections. I mean, also, there was a document published just a few days ago talking about the relation between the Turkish government and this Daesh, and we are ready to send it to yours because it was published in the media also. So it's just evidence about the connection between Daesh and them. And let's just review what happened. I mean, other than these attacks, Daesh was used to attack the Kurdish area and the Kurdish population in Rojava. And also Daesh, which they had many, many operations against the Kurds in the north. You know the Suruç explosion, you know the Diyarbakır explosion, and also you know the explosion in Ankara. All of them, they were targeting the Kurds. Only one explosion, one attack was against the Turkish government, which was in Istanbul airport. And those three people who done this this work or this operation, they came from out. They were not Daesh from inside Turkey or around. Three of them, maybe you know the idea of them, they were just came 1 month before. They were coming from Kyrgyzstan and Turkmenistan, whatever they are. It means it was a kind of punishment to Turkish government because they are not doing what is wanted from them. So other than all the operations done by Daesh was targeting the Kurds. And now, it's not our world. I mean, what they are doing in Jarablus and the areas, can you consider that just an invasion to Jarablus and the villages just took about 2 hours? Maybe sometimes you need two hours to change your clothes. I mean, instead of to be Daesh, to change to other form. So it just took a few hours, I mean, to occupy all these villages and Jarablus area without any fighting. There were two tanks, yes. They were hit by Daesh, and maybe two, three soldiers also were killed. I don't know. I have no explanation for that. But it means somebody inside Daesh is not obeying Turkey, or what happened, we don't know. It could be a kind of accident, I mean. Because the fighting, we know, the Daesh, how he was fighting, they were fighting in numbers, maybe for each centimeter of land, from house to house. And they were, just for your information, Daesh members killed in Manbij, there are more than 4,000 people, and they didn't leave Manbij. So how they can leave Jarablus without any casualties? It's unbelievable. So it's there is a kind of game between them and relation between them, which is already known, and we can supply you with the documents which was published a few days ago. Thank you.
Question for
you. I just have a question to Elisa and then one to Bilal. Firstly, Elisa, so we're talking about the importance of resuming the peace process. So, I mean, I want to talk about the dynamics in Turkey. What is the possibility of the HDP overtaking the PKK? You know, as we saw in Northern Ireland, there was a time when Sinn Féin actually became the real legitimate actor and people left the IRA to join Sinn Féin. Is this possible in Turkey, or is it the dynamics just too different and the leader too crazy? I just wanted to ask you about the KLG. What role can they play within this in helping the Kurds in both Turkey and Syria, considering how much they rely on Turkey for so much things? You know, what role can they actually play to help their brothers in the other two countries? Thank you.
Would you please also introduce yourself, you know, when you have questions? Sorry, I'm a little late.
I'm Dylan O'Driscoll.
Okay, first of all, there's absolutely no chance of the HDP overtaking the PKK. I mean, the HDP's,
HDP's base of support are the same people who support the PKK. The PKK exerts enormous influence over the HDP, and people in HDP owe their positions largely because PKK supporters vote for them, and because the PKK has said, this is our party, this is the one we support. So their areas of operation are very clear. HDP can help facilitate a peace process. Once there is a peace process, they can work in the parliament, they can build support for it, but there is absolutely no chance for them overtaking the PKK.
The second question was about KRG. What can they do to help? It depends on what you mean by help. There is a love and hate relationship between PYD and KDP, between PKK and KDP. And there is no such thing as KRG policy, because KRG does not have a single policy. KRG is a coalition, when you say government coalition, of different parties, which are now not the same as 2 years ago. So KRG doesn't have a policy. per se, except that they are very much affected by what happens in both Turkey and in Rojava. Kobani changed Iraqi Kurdistan. The images of these brave women sacrificing their fighting, this became like a very romantic, very symbolic. It empowered women, it made a lot of people sympathetic to PYD for their fighters. And that sympathy forced the KRG to change some policies and send them Peshmerga. There was at some point 150 Peshmerga with troops went there, and they did make a difference in Kobani, and they actually persuaded Turkey to let them go via Turkish area. And KRG, whether as a government or as parties, they are sending help and humanitarian at the time of need, but they are often also facing a problem crossing. So both sides are actually making life difficult for each other when it suits them, and they make life easy when it suits them. This is this has to change, obviously, and I think there's public pressure on both sides to do that. But certainly there was some serious efforts in 2000, and I don't know, maybe Kak Saleh remembers exactly when they were, these accords in or agreements in Erbil, then in Duhok, to normalize relations. If that had worked, the KRG could have done a lot more. But now, even KRG is under pressure from the surrounding area and so on. So I personally think that the best thing that both sides can do is have a serious dialogue, mutual recognition, build bridges, build confidence between them, and agree on certain minimum criteria. But this is not happening. I have a feeling that even Mr. Saleh Muslim himself is finding it difficult to go to Erbil. So let alone having this open gate policy between the two sides. So KRG can do a lot, not only in Kurdistan, but also even with Turkey and America in providing logistic, political and military help. I don't know if others can add to this. Maybe Kak Saleh himself can say more.
Well, regarding the relations with the KRG, we consider it's not KRG. KRG is supposed to be PUK and Goran and all the Kurdish hierarchies. We have a good relations with everybody, except PDK, which they have a good relation with Turkey. And I think this relation, I mean, with Turkey is really harming the relation of the Kurds. So now, if we are talking about Semarka, the gate between Rojava and KRG is under the control of Peshmerga, belong to PDK. It's not, we cannot blame all of the KRG because they are not accepting, I mean, this situation. So it's just used as a political tool, I mean, to make pressure on Rojava. I mean, with a big regret, of course, it's not acceptable, I mean, because in Rojava, we are under the siege, we are under embargo, nothing is received to Rojava, and we have difficulties, and maybe, I can say, many injured people from YPG members have been died, martyred, just because of lack of treatment or medical treatment. We don't have medicines to treat them in Rojava, and they don't allow them to go out. So this is the problem really we are suffering. And it's done, I mean, this is closed, we know that. It's just because of mutual benefits between the KRG, not KRG, or PDK and the AKP party, I mean the Turkish government. So if they just, and even ANKC, I mean, which is the Kurdish parties affiliated by just members, I mean, really we cannot say too much party. Even they, if they leave Ankara and Istanbul, if they come to Kurdistan, maybe we can discuss all the problems. There is no problem. And also for these agreements, which were agreed in Hawler 1 and Hawler 2 and even the Dehok agreement, I think just they were taking orders from Turkey not to, to do it, because even we tried to put the name of the democratic self-administration in Rojava, it's not accepted by them. They don't accept the name of it. So the instructions to them is not to recognize it, it's just to refuse any dealing with this administration. So this is the situation, really. It's not from our side. There is a system, and this system is existing since 3 years, and everybody accepted he can leave it. I mean, well, we cannot consider a part of land without any laws, without any rules, without any administration. It cannot be. So because of that, they have in some ways to deal with the administration. Maybe they can be the opposition, they can do it what they like, but at least they should deal with the system already established over there. So this is our dilemma, really. And of course, I mean, we are trying our best, I mean, to remedy what's is broken, what is not right. We are trying to do the right things, and even especially for the relations with the Kurdish parties in KRG and the other parties in the north, we would like to keep a good relation, really.
Can I just, because the question was addressed to me, I bounced it to Kaksala and now back to myself. Can I just say I disagree with much of what he said about the fact that it's all about Turkey and KDP, because KDP have not in the past behaved as proxy to Turkey. KDP has problems with PKK. They have territory in common. They are competing over resources, over influence. PKK has recently they had friction with PYD involved, of course, Ayman Yapak involved in Sinjar over the Yazidis. They have problem going back to 2-3 decades. So this relation has always been tough. And they had wars before. And of course, Turkey was not always involved. But just because the interests of Turkey and KDP at times align, and sometimes they're actually independent. I don't think we can reduce it down to this black and white of saying KDP is doing what Turkey wants. But of course, when their interests are aligned, they may do things together. But and it does take two to tango. I mean, basically, yes, Kaksala denies, or not very persuasively, that PKK and PYD are totally independent, but people don't see that way in the United States, people don't see that way in Turkey, people don't see that even in Iraqi Kurdistan. So whatever relation there is between KDP and PKK having a direct knock-on effect on KDP-PYD relation. So it's really not, and that's why I earlier said it's not really in black and white, and one, I fully understand that your point of view, from your point of view, this is how you see it. But actually, from above, it's never that simple. But I truly think that there are times that interests of different parties come together and alliances change and so on.
I just want to go back to our topic, actually, the Turkish intervention in Rojava. If you have questions about this, you know.
Yes, and thank you.
Can you introduce yourself?
Yes, of course. I'm Samuel Jordan, and Saleh Muslim. Very good seeing you again. And I am a recent participant in the conference in Sleimani, in which we were perhaps the only force in the Middle East talking about peace and stability. But concerns about your position there in PYD in Syria were prominent in our discussions, and I want to raise a question that I think our panelists have sort of at least told us might not be the most important. We should focus on the U.S., Kurds, and Turkey, but I want to speak about and ask your opinion too about a kind of development that might be a sleeper development here, particularly with the U.S. politics. That is, The recent rapprochement between Turkey and Israel, you know, Turkey has sort of mended fences with Russia about the bombing of his plane, and now has a kind of rapprochement with Israel following the problems with the aid boats. Now, what I'm asking is, such an alliance would be, from all appearances, at least what they've stated, anti-Kurdish, anti-Iranian, anti-Russian, anti-Saud, a kind of perfect arrangement for U.S. administration that is a little more militaristic than the Obama administration. You know, back in 2008, when there was a possibility that Hillary Clinton could be president, that was also a concern, a Turkish-Israeli axis in the Middle East. You know, the at least declared nuclear power with Turkey, a NATO ally, could present some problems that we hadn't anticipated. Well, we have almost that same scenario here now with this discussion or agreement between Turkey and Israel and a possibility of a Hillary Clinton presidency again, and perhaps a more militant or warlike approach to foreign policy than the Obama administration. So I'm asking if you think, too, that this Turkish-Israeli agreement is of no real significance, or if it can mean that there is a new force bringing additional pressures to the possibilities of Kurdish development in Syria.
Yes, should I answer? Yeah.
Yes, please.
Yeah. Well, of course, we are not against the relation between all the countries, because they think their interest and, of course, their goals, their gains. But, of course, I mean, we think, I mean, the relation is not in the expense of the Kurdish people, especially for the Israel. But for Turkey, well, because there is a kind of Kurdophobia with the Turkish government, and especially Erdogan. He accepts everything. I mean, can you imagine, I mean, the conflict between them and Israel, how they were saying, what they were saying, what they were demanding from Israel, and they just suddenly gave everything, gave up, and they went to Israel. So they made an agreement for many things, especially for these gas fields and the others to build things. I mean, it's mainly economic. And then their problem with the Russian, and also they went to Moscow for that. So they are ready to forget everything when the Kurdish Kurdish issue is a subject. So it's a kind of Kurdophobia. So they are ready to do everything just for the Kurdish people not to get any democratic rights in any place in the area. I mean, in the world even. So because of that, I don't think, because Israelis, we are not against Israeli and their benefits, and their, of course, they should have their relations. We are not against that. And we believe this relation, I mean, between Turkey and Israel is not against the Kurdish, looking, or Kurdish, of course, what's going on. They are not against the Kurds. We believe that.
I would just like to quickly throw my support behind what Salih Muslim said in terms of the Turkish-Israel agreement not being anti-Kurdish. I think some of how you described it actually is not correct. First of all, in Israel, there's a strong undercurrent of support for the Kurds. Always has been, and certainly recently, I believe it was the Justice Minister who was talking about Kurdish independence. At the same time, Israel has a strong history of engagement with the Kurds, specifically with the Iraqi Kurds. So there's a history there. And finally, let's not overstate the level of relations between Israel and Turkey. They're going back somewhat to what they were before, but there's a lot of mistrust on the Israeli side, I'm certain, of what's going on in Turkey vis-a-vis in the post-coup period, some of the anti-democratic measures, in terms of the role that radical Islamists have played, specifically ISIS, with attacks there. with allowing ISIS to transit territory. I would not overstate the level of this new agreement.
Excuse me, just one second, please. My question was to the instrumentality of that agreement, not necessarily whether or not Israel has a history of antagonism with Kurds, but we're talking about a new administration in the United States.
Thank you. I'm not speaking about so much Israeli antagonism with Kurds. Of course, your account of the history of their relationships with Kurds is not particularly antagonistic. But I'm speaking of the instrumentality of such an agreement in the United States with the advent of an administration whose policies we don't know, whether it's a Trump administration or a Clinton administration. This possibility gives them a chance, an opportunity to perhaps develop a policy initiative or policy initiatives in the Middle East with Turkey, through Turkey and Israel, that we haven't seen yet. But we do know that with Turkey's approach to opposition to any Kurdish autonomy or additional autonomy in Syria, and Israel's willingness, perhaps, to advance a number of U.S. policies, we have an instrument that can be, I think, of some importance in this conflict.
Thank you very much, sir. Can we have some other?
Hi, my name is Lucy and I'm from UCD Relief Fund. My question is to Professor Delaware, since you are talking on behalf of, or maybe in the name of KDP. So my question...
Wait. That I reject completely. Why? Why did you think I speak only?
Well, you made some statements.
I just said none of the Iraqi parties, KDP included, are proxies of Turkey or Iran or anybody. Mm-hmm. It's just not fair to describe this relation as if Turkey making KDP behave badly with these guys. I am not KDP, I do not advocate KDP, I am not pro-KRG, I do not advocate KRG. I am a think tank policy research institute representative.
But I would still highlight my question.
Fair.
And I would ask why KDP actually lifted this peshmerga from Shingal area and leaving Yazidis alone facing ISIS. And now, why KDP is asking Yazidis to not accept any help, military help from PYD, and actually we have cases where KDP Peshmerga have killed Yazidi, youth for supporting PYD.
If there's any KBP here, could they answer? I cannot answer this question. You're a KDP?
No, I'm PUK.
Okay, my name is Fazal Kurdi. I am the executive director.
I gave the mic the other person, then after that, can
sure.
Give, I'm sorry.
Was that one?
Him, please.
Hi, I'm Anton Arthur from Baltimore, and I wanted to ask a question for Aliza Marcus in regards to the importance of political pluralism as a U.S. requirement to act as a mediator between Turkey and the PKK,
which is the reason for
the reason for the Turkish incursion into Syria is the war between the PKK and Turkey.
While I think it's important for Tevdim, well, I think it's important for Tevdim to encourage political pluralism and let Ruta say whatever Ruta wants to say, because Tevdim wants a free society. Is political pluralism actually a requirement for the United States? Because they have been indifferent to the suppression of the HDP and the Regions Party in Turkey and for democracy in Kurds in Turkey.
For decades, as you well know. They seem indifferent to
Barzani now acting
outside of the draft constitution in Kurdistan and suppressing Goron, the second largest party. And regionally, we know the U.S. makes political and strategic alliances with Saudi Arabia and Qatar, no friends of democratic process or plurality. What do we need to do to get the U.S. to act as a mediator for peace between Turkey and the PKK if it really doesn't care about political pluralism?
Well, I don't think the U.S. needs to care about political pluralism all the time to use it now and then when it serves to its benefit. So specifically in this case, because political pluralism and free speech and allowing Rudao and other groups to operate in Rojava is one of the issues that people use to criticize PYD and to try to marginalize them, I think it's important that if the U.S. does choose to engage with the PYD more on a more stable level, which I think it should, I think it's very important, it would be useful for the U.S. to raise this as an issue, and certainly I believe they would want to. I mean, on the larger question of the U.S. mediating between PKK and Turkey, I don't actually think that's possible right at this moment, unfortunately, largely because I don't see a will on, mainly on Ankara's side, to engage in a renewed peace process.
Okay, can we give the mic back to Jeff? I'm sorry. You want on the track?
Basil Kurdi, executive director of Kurdus and Aid, at the same time I'm teaching a Kurd and their original role in the area, except especially with the fight with ISIS, with the different U.S. agencies between time and time. My question is for Kurt Sarah Muslim. Where is the status of the political or diplomatic relation between Rojava and the U.S.? Recently, we all know that the top diplomatic person was on the ground in Rojava. So I need to know what's the status between a diplomatic relation between you guys and the U.S.? My other question is for the panel. I think there was a blanket statement about the KRG policy against Rojava, which I disagree on that one. That's true, there is no KRG policy. The KRG policy is backed up by KDP policy. KDP policy is implemented in KRG and against the PYD or the Rojava. Thank you.
Should we have like two more questions maybe?
Can he answer my question, please?
Yeah, he's Mr. Saleh, would you answer the question after we hear the other audiences as well, please? Yes, you can ask the question. Okay. Is this for Mr. Saleh?
Yes.
Okay. Can you introduce yourself?
My name is Hande Akhmet, Hologram Network Consulting. I don't think it's working.
I think
yeah. My questions were also Mr. Salih Muslim. Hypothetically, if Turkey goes back to the dialogue process or the solution process or a new process, how would PYD's official standing be towards Turkey's proposed safe zone in Syria? How would some of the dynamics change from your perspective and from PYD's official perspective towards the safe zone? Thank you.
Mr. Saleh?
If the question is for me, I couldn't hear any question. Could you repeat it, please?
So we had two questions for you, actually. The first...
Well, I'm not hearing very well, please.
Can you talk to the stick next in front of you?
Mr. Saleh, we have one question.
Yeah.
Can you hear us?
Well, not too much. Would you repeat the questions, please?
Taksala, can you hear me, brother?
Can you hear me, Taksala? Well, a little bit, yes.
How about that? Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay, Taksala, my question was about the U.S.-Rojava relation. We all know that there's advisors on the ground from DOD, but at the same time, my question was,
what's the latest status about the diplomatic relation between Rojava and the U.S. Recently, within last week, there was a top envoy of Obama administration. He was his representative. He was on the ground, Mr. Brett McGurk. I need to know, where are you at this case? Where are you? What's the, what, did you start dialogue? Did you, where is the political process between Rojava and the U.S.?
Okay, and we have another question.
Okay.
Would you please stand? Could you repeat, please? You can ask this question, too.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, so second question is, if the peace process or a dialogue process restarts in Ankara, how would PYD's official position change with regards to the safe zone proposed by Turkey in Syria? Thanks.
Well, for the first question, I think there is a very well coordination in the military side, and this cooperation between the YPG and after that Democratic Syrian Forces with the International Alliance against Daesh, it was very successful. And it's still continuing till now. I don't know the details of the recent developments over there, but it's, I am sure the cooperation is going very well. From the political side, of course, also we are dealing in some ways with Mr. Michael Ratney, which is the special envoy for the Syrian conflict, and also with Mr. Brett McGurk, which is responsible for the fighting against Daesh. Yes, he was recently in Kobani and he met the people from Democratic Syrian Forces. He met some people from YPG and even from the administration. Well, I don't know exactly what they have talked about, but I'm sure our people over there, they said they were satisfied with these negotiations. And of course, I mean, we would like, as a political party and the administration in Rojava, we would like to have very good relations, political relations and diplomatic relations with the United States. And I think it will be for our benefit and even for the Americans, American people also. Well, especially in this time, because the enemies of our people and the United States people, just like Daesh and the extremists, the only secular force who is fighting them is Democratic Syrian Forces and the Kurdish people. The secularism is a part of their nature because there are some of them Muslims, there are some of them Yazidis, Christians, and so. I mean, they are used to be a secular and naturally. So, well, at that, we would like to have a good relation, better relations with the United States and the United States institutions, I mean, in politically and diplomatically. For the second question, well, I didn't understand very well, but I think they were talking about the dialogue with Ankara. Well, every day they are still blaming us as a terrorist, trying to connect us with Daesh with others, which is this conditions is not, I mean, convenient for any dialogue. As you know, our peaceful hand and friendship was extended to Ankara many times. We will still, I mean, our hand is up. I mean, we would like to have a good relations. We are not enemies to the Turkish people at all. Maybe in future, if they just give up blaming us as a terrorist organization and connect us with the terrorists, at that time maybe we can have a dialogue in some ways. And I think it should be, I mean, and even for the stand of Turkey against the Syrian conflict, because we are Syrians and we would like for democracy or this federalism, decentralized solution for all Syria. It's not only for the Kurdish people. So if they accept it, we wouldn't reject any relations with Turkey also.
We have a last question. We are doing live streaming right now. I think we have a question online. Are you ready?
Hello, can you hear me?
Can you pass the mic, please?
Well, first of all, I would like to thank all the speakers for sharing the valuable news with us. My question is for Professor Hanadi, who said that Kurds should not make the U.S. to be sides between the Turks and Kurds. But if they don't, how Kurds can secure U.S. support without pushing for political recognition and acceptance of the process? As Alza Marcus said, the U.S. has excluded Kurds from the political process, such as the Geneva talks, all this time, and will continue to do so if the Kurds don't push actually the U.S. for a Kurdish political recognition. So what does the matter? To kind of convince the U.S. to accept the Kurds and think of them in the political process. Thank you.
Well, that's a great question. I think PYD and the Kurds in Syria in general have been very successful in doing what nobody else could ever do. And that is having such a balanced relation with so many enemies that they have good relation with Bashar, but they fight Bashar at the same time. They have good relation with Russia. Russia one day treats them as ally against Turkey, and then won the relation with Turkey. So they had Russia on their side. They managed to get America on their side. They managed to effectively have good relations with so many players that no other force on the ground in Syria could achieve so much. So really a sign of very good instinct of survival game. I'm not talking about now more, but there was a time, and different times maybe, but there was a time when only PYD had good relation with everybody, including, by the way, KDP and Turkey. Kak Salih Muslim was traveling via Turkey. How many other people could actually achieve that? Now, that is the way to go. Engage everybody, good relation, bridges, invest in it, and don't cut those channels. With the United States is in a very delicate position. Turkey is very important for the United States. They cannot afford to lose Turkey. And United States decided that for Daesh, for fighting ISIS, PYD is extremely important, or YPG. They are the only ones in Syria who can fight ISIS. So that is a valued alliance or partnership. On one hand, we must make sure that the U.S. does not treat the Kurds as mercenaries. Okay, they are not for hire. They have a cause. They have a reason to fight, and they do establish a governance system that is better than anyone else in Syria. But at the same time, sometimes this relation could be like a cat and mouse game. When America gets into agreement, say, this is how far I'd like you to go, but be careful, I have to deal with Turkey as well. And suddenly, YPG may push boundaries, push red lines, and then say, no, I'm going to take Jarablus, do that. Well, that provokes Turkey. When it provokes Turkey so badly, Turkey comes in, where does the United States stand? They may, at some point, have to make some decisions. If you avoid that, make sure that the United States does not need to choose between Turkey and Kurds. That's where you want to be. That balance, that niche where you benefit from everyone's policies, but never make them choose between that. And I want also to appeal to Kak Saleh. No matter what you say, Kak Saleh, in words, indeed, in action, people see what you do. America behaves with hand in heart, say, for God's sake, distance yourself from PKK in action. Do not let me